Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar. I hope everyone can hear us all right. Welcome this afternoon, I guess, and this morning, depending where you're located at today. We're thrilled to have you all joining us as we talk today about buying strategy and how to make your buyer into an investor within your retail environment. My name is Casey Higgs, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. Joining me today, we've got both Jimmy Richberg, Rick's Client Success Director, as well as Nick Stanko, owner at Ann Arbor Running Company. But before we jump in, I would like to run over just a few housekeeping tips. As you can see on this slide, the webinar will be recorded and we'll make it available to all after the event. We'll also be live tweeting the webinar. So first of all, make sure you follow us at Rick Software. And if you add to the conversation on social media using the hashtag MakeMoreMoney, you'll be able to follow along and contribute. For an optimal webinar experience, all of the participants have been muted. Although if you do have any questions, we certainly encourage you to ask them. Simply type them into the Zoom chat or the Q&A panel, and we'll do our best to answer those throughout the webinar. If we don't get to them during the webinar, we will have time, though, at the end for a Q&A. And let's get started. As I mentioned, we are going to be live tweeting this webinar. So if you do join in the conversation, there is an incentive waiting for you at the end of it. Use the hashtag MakeMoreMoney when you tag us in your social media post at Brick Software, and we'll send you some free caffeine. So let's just get right into it. Before I hand it over to Jimmy, I'd really like to know who is out there who's listening to us today. So we're going to take a quick poll. And the question here, you'll be able to answer via your screen, is simply, who currently handles buying at your store? Is it A, the owner, B, the buyer, C, the store manager, or D, other? Now, you are welcome to select all that apply. So please feel free to do that now. We've already got plenty of answers coming in. It looks like thus far over 50% of those that handle buying are officially the buyer at their store versus falling under another role or, you know, someone with multiple hats. And as the rest of the responses come in, that seems to be about accurate. The owner is the second most popular individual responsible for buying, it looks like, based on those that have responded. So that's good. So we've got plenty of people interested here today, Jimmy. And as we click out of here, some notifications, we will get right into this. All right. So Jimmy, I'll go ahead and hand it all over to you. Tell us about the retail landscape. What the heck's going on there? What are these trends all about?
Yeah, thanks, Casey. So we've all heard the narrative. Brick and mortar is dead. E-commerce is king, and that's the way the kind of the retail market is moving. Despite the growing popularity and prevalence of the e-commerce, brick and mortar is certainly not dead, and definitely far from it. And if you want proof of that, you need to look no further than kind of the king of e-com themselves, with Amazon, who just this past summer spent $13 billion to acquire 470 brick and mortar locations with their acquisition of Whole Foods. And they continue to open bookstores across the country to because they themselves even recognize the importance of brick and mortar when it pertains to the customer experience and how customer expectations are changing. So the biggest driver of the shift we're seeing inside of retail is definitely coming from the consumer. Their expectations are changing in terms of the experience they're going to have, the ease of being able to buy the products that they need. And it's going to continue to evolve as, especially as technology becomes more and more prevalent in our everyday lives. So people live through their phones. It's very easy to find access to any information at the tip of your fingers. It's also very easy to be one click away from virtually any item that you could possibly want. So making the experience as convenient and as close to meeting their expectations as possible is what's going to keep the customer coming into the store and keep you kind of driving business.
So what does this mean for the retailer?
So what we're going to focus on from this standpoint is the inventory aspect of the brick and mortar locations. And inventory is going to be a huge key in terms of how you are accommodating the needs and the expectations of your customers. And also, how you best, organizing your cash flow and investing in the right products. So that's what we're going to focus on today. So in order to stay competitive, in order to have the right product, you need to effectively manage your inventory, specifically your unsold inventory. You want to ensure that you have the products that your customers want, you're moving out the things that aren't doing very well, and you're investing your cash where it makes the most sense. But how? So the way we want to think about buying is no longer simply buying inventory, but investing in inventory. The basics of investing is you want to put your money into something that's going to give you the greatest return. So instead of thinking of yourself as a buyer or your buyer as just a buyer, think of them as your strategic investor in your inventory. So, being able to do this is going to give you a greater confidence in your inventory and ultimately in your staff as they make these buying or investment decisions as you're bringing in inventory to present to your customers. So what you want to do is determine your buying strategy first and foremost. You want to be able to have a plan that you're going to act against in order to effectively manage your inventory. And that's what we'll kind of go through here today.
Right. So where does everyone start?
So the first thing you want to do is set goals for yourself and for your business. If you don't have goals, it's very difficult to manage your inventory because you really have nothing to compare it to. The big question that we get from people is, as they're becoming, more in tune with, buying effectively, having a buying strategy and setting goals, it's tough to even know, where to start. So what we want to do is show you, kind of talk a little bit about what's happening in the market. And in this case, it's specifically Run Specialty, but how we are going to,
So design fault here, that would be definitely responsibility I'll take here. We're looking at some of the market benchmarks here, as Jimmy was saying, and we've got gross profit percentage, ROI, and turns up here. And we got some new information, hence the lack of an updated slide here. But what Jimmy is about to present to you is the different market benchmarks as they break down across footwear and apparel and a couple other industries.
So, one of the most common things that people are looking at when they're analyzing their data and they're buying is you're looking usually at the number of units you're selling as well as your overall sales. While those are important, and we'll kind of dive into that a little bit more as we move through here, three other metrics that we're going to either introduce or that you may be familiar with already are gross profit, ROI, and turns. So gross profit is obviously your profit margin on any given product. Your ROI is going to be your return on investment. So for every dollar you invest in a product, how many you getting in return, and your turn rate is going to be how many times you are selling through or turning over your inventory over the course of a year. So utilizing these metrics is pretty crucial in terms of really being able to effectively manage your inventory, because it tells you a lot about how things are performing and what your next step should be.
Awesome. And for those of you joining in, we will have those updated numbers out on the slide that we send out after this event. Thank you all for your patience.
So as we go into this, one thing I'll note is that you can, think a way to think about it is being able to improve your cash flow by 1% every week for every 1 week of improvement in your inventory turns. So with that, before we dive into kind of the specifics of, the buying strategy and specifically utilizing your data, I'll turn it over to Nick to talk a little bit about the buying strategy inside of Ann Arbor Running Company. Nick?
Yep, I'm here. Hey, how's it going, everybody? Thanks for attending today. We're pretty new at Ann Arbor Running Company. We're only a 3-year-old store, and we're still learning a ton. But as we got started, we just kept things really tight, really lean. Myself and my business partner weren't huge number guys. We don't have like an MBA or anything. So we've done this for a while. We kind of have a feel for it. So we've just really, this picture here kind of shows you one of our stores, inventory space. So, this is our smaller store. But as you can see here, we have only a certain amount of space to work within, And this is kind of our benchmark that we've used to get started. Same with our shoe wall and our apparel throughout the store. You know, we have so many spaces on the shoe wall for shoes. We have so many spots for apparel. If something new has to come in, something has to be gone and taken off the wall or taken off that apparel hook. So that's kind of how we've got started. And then now as we kind of have been using Rick's more and more, they've been able to help us kind of, I guess, digest those numbers and make sense of them.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, Nick. So, you know, once you've gone through and kind of established your goals based off information you're getting from the market, or if you have a good idea of what it is you're going for, the next step is really going to be focusing in on your data. Data is probably more important now inside of retail than it ever has been before, because that's really going to be what guides you into making the most efficient, most profitable decisions. So we're going to dive in a little bit here on how you can best utilize your data to help kind of drive and manage your inventory.
Yeah. So Jimmy, what's that process like?
So the way we like to talk about approaching it is looking at it from both a supplier or a vendor level and then a product level. So evaluating the overall performance of your suppliers, identifying who's doing well and who's not, and then diving a level deeper and seeing which products inside of those suppliers are performing well and which ones aren't. It's also helpful to break this out and think of it in different categories. So looking at it in footwear, apparel, and accessories as kind of separate categories to make sure you're comparing those specific items that category to, you know, only that category.
Interesting. And then how often would you go through this actual process?
So it really depends on kind of what your buying cycle looks like, how you're ordering from your vendors, but some kind of a good framework is looking at it from a monthly, a quarterly, and annual basis. It's always good to stay up on what's happening weekly, but it's very hard to get enough information after a week of sales to make effective decisions. So looking at some of these things from a broader scale and then adjusting accordingly is going to be your best way to go about it.
Awesome.
So, you know, with that, we'll dive into talking about identifying supplier performance and then identifying product performance and forecasting inventory.
So, Jimmy, if you wouldn't mind going through some of those numbers that, you know, what would we be looking at if we if we're looking at our supplier performance, where do you even start?
So the, like I said before, the most common way people are looking at it is starting by looking at units and dollars, which is great. It is important to know, you know, how many units you're selling and kind of what are the overall sales of that vendor. Additional points I would look at when you're analyzing your suppliers is to also look at the number of SKUs you have and also how the, and then as you dive in, look at how the SKUs are performing. And we'll go into that in a little bit more detail as we get to the product performance section. But then additionally, you know, bringing up those key performance indicators we talked about earlier, which are gross profit, ROI, and turns. Like I said, those are going to be kind of key driving factors in how you can analyze your inventory and how you can ultimately make decisions. So as you're looking at your supplier performance and you're looking at these metrics, finding out which of these suppliers are meeting or are above what your expectations or your goals are for those metrics, and then identifying which ones are underperforming and, you know, kind of starting with those ones who are underperforming to identify what is it that's causing those, you know, that supplier to be underperforming compared to the rest of them.
Gotcha. But you got to start at that supplier level in the first place to see how the brand is performing overall. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, it gives you a good guide because obviously there you have a lot of suppliers, you have a lot of product, and you, overall you have a lot of data that you're trying to sort through. So if you can quickly, you know, first identify who kind of your underperformers are go into that one in more detail, it's going to save you from looking through every supplier and trying to identify, you know, sort through all of that data in an effective time to make decisions.
Awesome. Now, how about product performance then specifically after you're looking at a supplier?
Yeah. So once you've analyzed your suppliers and, you know, we'll stick with the example of looking at your underperformers, the first thing to do is, you know, dive in and see kind of which products may be doing well for that supplier and which ones are kind of taking down the performance. So one of the things I had mentioned in the supplier piece is you have, looking at the total number of SKUs you're carrying for a particular supplier in that category, and then seeing how well those SKUs are performing. So if you carry, let's say, 20 different SKUs from a particular supplier, but only, 5 to 10 of them are actually, giving you a good return and giving you good profitability, what makes more sense is to take the money you've invested in the inventory for the underperforming products or the products that aren't doing well and reinvest it in the stuff that is doing well and ensuring that you have that product on hand because that's clearly what the customer wants to buy. You'll kind of ensure that way, one, you're not missing sales, and two, you're also investing in product that's going to give you that better return and ultimately allow you to keep reinvesting in those top performing products.
Awesome. Thank you, Jimmy. And for those that are visually tuning in right now, we are trying to find those correct stats slides so that you get the complete visual here. I know many of you that have joined us today know that here at Rick's, we're making a big effort to humanize our brand and ensure we're coming across as authentic as possible as humans to both our clients and our prospects. And this is just one example of us showing up as humans. We're not perfect. We can't always get all the dots or the T's crossed and the I's dotted, but we certainly do our best, and we're going to get you this great data no matter what. So thank you, Jimmy. Let's just keep moving forward here. Sure. So talk to us about, we've got all of this great data here, but what about the human side of it?
Yeah. So, once you've gone through, you've analyzed your data, as a buyer, or as an owner, you have, anywhere from 15 to 20 different brands you're trying to keep track of at any given time. So an important way to help you kind of, be more efficient in terms of managing your data and making the best decisions is creating relationships with your vendors and with your reps. I was a former footwear buyer for, a retail location. I know that at one point in time, sharing data with your vendors was almost kind of an unheard of thing because you would end up sharing the data for, what's doing well, what's not, and then they end up just trying to fill in wherever you have gaps in the inventory, which isn't an effective strategy for them, for you, and for your overall business. But over the past 2 years especially, many of the brands have put a lot of resources behind educating their reps on how to actually use and read the data that the stores are providing to them. So we're in a kind of a time in this now where they recognize the importance of data. They also recognize the importance of understanding the data in order to make decisions. So be more open. My recommendation is to be more open with sharing the information and empower your rep to help grow their brand inside of your business. That's the big thing. The goal of them should not be to help you grow your overall business when they're, they only impact a part of it. But if they focus on growing, if your Brooks rep focuses on growing their brand inside of your store and the rest of your brands can kind of follow suit, you're ultimately going to be able to grow your business that way. With that, it's also, setting expectations with your brand as you do anyone else on your staff. You're going to be sharing the data with them openly. The expectation for them should be that they're going to analyze that information. They're going to take it and help you make decisions based off of what's working and what's not. And this becomes especially important as you get into those sell-in meetings. Historically, those tend to be, okay, well, let me show you what I've got in the bag. We'll show you everything that we have, and then we'll kind of pick what you want. Those meetings now should be definitely more about the planning aspect based off of, historical sales from the same season the previous year. And then some of the items that the brand specifically will be pushing from a marketing standpoint. So if you've presented them with the information that they need prior to that, them coming in, they can prepare. It's going to be a much more productive conversation than it would be to just sit there and kind of look at what all the new product is.
That's a great point. And I know that there are even a few other things you can do to prepare for such meetings. Tell us about maybe some of the questions that you really want to directly ask your vendors when you're looking at new products and new trends. Just going to catch up with you here with the slides.
Yeah. So, I think as you're going out and you're talking to them, one of the things you should be asking if you're not sure is, what should you be buying? And that's based off of kind of what they're going to be pushing, from a marketing standpoint, what they know is doing well in the market in general, what they feel like will do well inside of your market, based off of kind of how you're selling other product. And as much information as they have and you have combined to kind of produce the best buying plan for your particular business.
Right. They ought to have a good idea of what is selling well, what's popular out there, What about new products?
So I think when it comes to new products, the big thing is to identify first, is that brand doing well with you in general? If so, you know, looking at to see how many SKUs you're carrying currently, and then how many of them are performing well and giving you the best return, you know, producing the greatest margin. And if you identify a brand that's doing particularly well, and you believe that adding another SKU could help kind of further grow that brand and overall grow your business, it's always good to kind of see what else is out there. I had this experience with a brand when I was a buyer. They came into the sell-in meeting and, you know, they wanted to add an additional SKU to the wall. And my challenge back to them was, well, show me that we can do well with this current SKUs that we have. And if we see the results, you know, come the next buying season, we'll consider adding another SKU. So over the course of the next few months, consistently shared data with them. You know, they helped manage kind of the inventory, removing the stuff that wasn't doing well, making sure we had enough of what was. And by the time the next sell-in came around, we were ready to add an additional SKU for them, and they continued to perform well.
Definitely seems much less risky than just going out on your own. Last question to ask your vendors.
Yeah, so kind of as I highlighted before, you know, they may not be able to say specifically of their accounts who's carrying a particular product, but you want to know that if there's a business similar to yours, similar market, similar customer base, are they carrying a product that you are, and how well is it doing? Or if it's something you're considering bringing in, you know, is it doing well inside of those similar markets? To know that, you know, if you market it right, if you're training the staff right to sell it to the customer, you know, does that product have a potential to do well also? You know, the big thing kind of, as I highlighted at the beginning, was that the relationship with your brand definitely needs to be two way. You want to provide them with the information that, you know, they need in order to help you grow. And then they need to in turn take that information and do what they can to grow their brand. You know, the goal should be to grow the brand, but definitely still meeting what your expectations are. And, you know, following your plan, making recommendations as they see fit. But you know, the goal is to work together to ultimately help manage the inventory as effectively as possible and grow the business.
That's great. Now, you talked a lot about expectations, which is a great segue into the step four of the four-step process into investing in your inventory, not buying your inventory. Tell us a little bit about how, you know, once you get something like this set up, how you keep it going.
So the big thing as far as a maintenance standpoint is, one is always going to be consistency. Consistency is kind of my number one rule of, you know, once you've established a process, once you've established a strategy, how do you keep it going? How do you get the results you're looking for? So if you get a strategy that works, you know, you've created a good relationship with particular reps, that seems to be working, the brands are growing, you know, staying on top of, you know, the things that we're making that work is going to be important. And then additionally, just setting the expectations from day one and making sure that everybody involved delivers on them. That is yourself, that's your buyer, you know, if you are that person, you know, and that's with your rep as well. You know what needs to happen in order to grow the business. So constantly maintaining that level of expectation is going to continue to, you know, allow you to see the growth and the return on investing in your inventory.
Yeah, that's great. I can see the benefits of something like this with staff turnover as well. That is unfortunate to the retail industry. So what about all of those individuals out there that are saying, you know, Jimmy, everything you say sounds great. You know, we've got all this great data, but I don't have time. I don't have all the resources I need to do something like this. What do you say to them?
So I think the big takeaway with that is, in, you know, where we are in the current retail market, you almost don't have a choice anymore. The market is shifting so rapidly and so drastically that if you don't find a way to adapt, you're going to kind of get left behind and end up having to play a little bit of catch up. So, you know, knowing the importance of this and finding the time to, you know, initially go through and set up the process, set up the strategy, and then just maintaining it. So the hardest part really is going to be establishing that initial process and what that strategy is and kind of getting all of the players and all the people involved in that process on the same page. And once you have that established, if you're staying consistent, if you're doing the right things, it becomes a lot easier and it just becomes a part of kind of, you know, the regular day to day. You know, and especially when you get to something like high staff turnover, you know, losing an experienced buyer is obviously a big hit to, you know, any retail business, you know, specifically, you know, in the, you know, kind of the small to medium businesses. So that's where kind of the consistency and the process outline comes into play. So regardless of, you know, who is responsible for doing it, if you're moving, if you have different people coming in, you know, if there's more than one person that's ordering, if everybody's following the same process, it's a lot easier to get somebody up to speed when somebody else leaves than it would be if you didn't have that process. This is a point where it's also really helpful and really valuable to have that strong relationship with your vendor because they can also work with that person to help kind of guide them in the right direction. Because you know, as an owner, as a buyer, you obviously have a lot going on. So having them assist in that process is extremely valuable. I was fortunate enough to have reps who were, you know, able to provide that type of guidance for me as I was just kind of learning, you know, the trade of being able to buy footwear and manage the inventory directly. And it worked out very well. So, you know, consistency, process, and maintaining those relationships to help kind of drive your goal. So with that, Nick, I'll turn it over to you again so you can kind of talk a little bit about your performance over the past few years since coming under Rick's.
Yeah, Jimmy's, you know, been right here. You know, we've seen the growth. You know, we see that kind of new store growth. It's kind of leveling off a little bit as we kind of settle in. But we were able to open a second location kind of in the demand that we saw. We've been sticking to our goals. One thing we've done is kind of stayed really consistent. And even though we've had that growth, we've tried to, you know, not get too excited and kind of start overbuying or anything. We've been happy with these results. Luckily, you know, I guess in our situation, the owners are still the buyers and we're still paying the bills. So, you know, we have a constant day-to-day hand on those numbers, but I can see as we grow, you know, it's going to be important that we have these things written down for our buyers, that it's very clear that these are the benchmarks. We need to stay within these kind of metrics so that things kind of, you know, stay the way they are.
All right, great. Thanks, Nick.
Nick, that's a great point too. Just to bring this all back together, the polling question we asked at the beginning was about the responsibility of buying inventory, of investing in inventory, and where that responsibility falls. Oftentimes with smaller retailers, it is the owner, and you are probably much more careful with your money because it is that. It is yours. When someone else comes in, and while they may be full of passion for the product or whatnot, it's at the end of the day, not their money. So how do we make sure we're paying attention to that bottom line and thinking about buying as investing? This is great. Thank you so much, Nick, for sharing.
So kind of as a summary and a review back to the topics that we talked about today, you know, again, the focus is to start thinking about your buying strategy is really more of an investing strategy and getting that person who's buying to be, you know, to think about it the same way, thinking strategically about where they're investing your money to ultimately, you know, improve your cash flow, put the dollars behind the items that are going to do the best for you and continue to meet the customer's expectations in a rapidly changing market. So you want to go through and you want to set your goals. You want to decide on what is going to be best for your business and whether that's basing it on what you see in the market or what you know has worked for you in the past, what you're hearing from your reps. From there, utilizing your data. I cannot emphasize this point enough that data is one of the most important factors in effective inventory management and inventory investing more now than it ever has been. And this is only going to continue to become more important. You know, all of the different data points that we highlighted today are easily available in the reports that we have in Rick's. And, you know, to kind of clean reports that you can review, be able to share with your vendors, which takes me into that point three, which was creating that relationship with your brands. Also going to be extremely important. You know, they are watching the market shift kind of as everyone else is, and they want to make sure that they're going to stay effective inside of the brick and mortar locations that they're selling into. You know, if they do well inside of your business grows, you know, and you know, their business grows with you. So it's kind of a win-win for everybody when you're kind of empowering them to help you grow. And the kind of the last piece of it is to, you know, just maintain, once you've established what's working, keep setting those expectations and making sure that everybody responsible is delivering on them, is going to be kind of crucial. Like I said, consistency is the key with these things. And if you want to see that continued return, and continued, you know, profitability, consistency is going to drive you there.
Awesome. Thank you, Jimmy. So set expectations from day one. As we wrap up today's content, I know that we do still have a few minutes for Q&A. For those of you out there that have yet to submit a question, if you have one, please feel free to do so now. It looks like our first question comes from Paul. And Paul asks, what are the three key reports that you should run monthly to help you set buying goals?
So if we're, you know, talking specifically from a Rick standpoint, I would say they're going to be the sales analysis, the stock status, and the bestseller report are three good ones. The sales analysis and the bestsellers are going to give you, you know, at the supplier and the SKU level, a look at those key performance indicators that we highlighted. And then the stock status is going to allow you to kind of dive in and look at the size performance across your, either your footwear category, your apparel category, and make sure that you're buying to kind of meet where your highest demand is on a particular size bell curve.
That's awesome. Now, for those that are lucky, that aren't lucky enough to maybe to be a partner of Rick's, what can they do with the data that they have to make the best, if you will?
I think that the advice I would say is find the reports that are going to give you those metrics. So, you know, looking at units, dollars, and then margin, ROI, and turns, like I said, those are going to be the driving metrics in terms of the best way for you to make decisions. You know, find the cleanest way to produce those reports so that you can, you know, go through and read them, understand them, as well as, you know, a clean way to be able to share them with your reps so that, you know, they can do the same, that you guys are speaking the same language, you're looking at the same thing. And then, you know, being kind of regular about running those reports and analyzing those reports so that, again, you're kind of being consistent and you're paying attention to, you know, where your money is going and what the return is that's being produced.
Great. Thank you. Looks like we have time for at least one more question. And Nick, I'd love for you to chime in here if you can. This question comes from Kathy, who asks, how do you use Rick's to help plan futures?
Looking at the previous year and I guess seeing, how things were performing, obviously what's sold, you know, quarterly, we usually break it down. So over a 3-month period, also, you know, we are in the store most days of the week, so we have a good hand on kind of what's performing and what's not. But I can see as we kind of grow and things change here, these numbers and looking at the reporting will be, you know, even more and more important each year.
Yeah, that's great, Nick. Thank you.
All right. I think we'll take one last question. We've got one more minute here. This question comes from Ted, and it's about trying new products. Ted's question is, when trying a new shoe, when do you kill a poor performer?
I would say once you've brought the shoe in, I would be looking at it after its, you know, first month to 2 months of performance. And if you feel like it's underperforming, the first question to ask yourself is, why is it underperforming? Because what you very well may find is that it's the right product for your market, it's the right fit, but the staff may not be confident in bringing it out and selling it to your customers. So if that's the case, you may find that it's only underperforming because it's just not being presented to the customers. If you talk to your staff and you say, you know, people are bringing it out, customers just don't seem to like it. If you're finding it doesn't really fit with your market, that's kind of a point where you might want to go back to your rep and say, you know, this isn't really working. Is there something else that we can do? Or is there a better way that we might be able to drive this? But, if you identify, you know, after those 1 to 2 months that the product really isn't working, that's a good time to kind of say, you know, we need to do something different, because what you don't want to do is get to the end of that product life cycle, for that particular model, that particular style, and then be, you know, kind of loaded down with excess inventory and, you weren't able to sell it well while it was in season. So it's not really going to be more difficult to do it when it's out of season. It's going to require really high markdowns. And, you know, if you can even break even on kind of what your cost was, let alone just having to end up donating it to move it out.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. I know we've had quite a few additional questions come in here in these last few minutes. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get to them today, but we will absolutely follow up with them after this event, either via phone or via email. And once again, you will all get access to this great content here later today, including some of those benchmarks that we weren't able to get to. I know there were, in fact, a few specific questions about those. So please feel free to continue reaching out to us with other questions. Jimmy and Nick, I can't thank you both enough for your time and your insight on investing in inventory. And please, to all those out there, follow up with us with additional questions and feel free to browse the Rick's blog for some additional insight and best practice resources. So I will leave it at that. I wish you all a wonderful Wednesday and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thanks, Casey.
Thanks for joining us.